And now we are moving toward the next session, and that is basically goes to the Dr. Jaya Kumar Chokalingam, who is the librarian of IIT Roorkee. But before that, I want to acknowledge here our very respectful person, our former Vice Chancellor Suresh Prasad Singh, sir. Good morning, sir. How are you? And I am really thankful to your presence into this particular seminar, and will give some insight your experience. Thank you so much, sir. So let me introduce the Dr. Jay Kumar Chokalingam, who is the librarian of IIT Roorkee, and it's our pleasure to hear to share their experiences and more information about to the library and publishing. And I am 100% sure that this information will be fruitful to all those who are young researchers. So, Dr. Jaya Kumar basically is a member of Royal Society of Chemistry, Indian Library Advisory Board, member of IOP Publishing India Library Advisory Board, member of Cambridge University Press South Asia Library Advisory Board. Dr. Jaya Kumar Chokalingam is a librarian, as I had mentioned earlier, into the IIT Roorkee, and is basically leading the library team since March 2016. Prior to joining IIT Roorkee, he was with the Indian School of Business, Mohali campus, as Associate Director, Learning Resource Center, a reference librarian at the Indira Gandhi Center for Atomic Research, Kalpakkam, and also served as a librarian at the Radio Astronomy Center, TIFR, Ooty. He started his professional career as a school librarian and Good Shepherd Public School, Ooty, in the year 1984. Great, sir. His interests include the design and planning of libraries, implementing innovative information services, resource evaluation and implementation, and imparting resource discovery tool and technique. Sir, most welcome, and over to you, sir. Sir, unmute, please. Dr. Jay Kumar, sir, please unmute your mic.
No, it's not
Yeah, yes,
allowed.
now it is audible. Everything is fine.
Could you hear me
Thank you.
now?
Yes, everything is fine, sir. Thank you.
Thank you, Professor Sushil, for your kind words, and I'm very happy to be part of today's program. And very nice to listen to some of the discussion earlier also. I joined pretty early, so nice actually, and nice to see that is more than 120 participants are there online,
Yes.
and very happy to be there. So today's discussion, I'll just share some of my few points which I feel very much relevant to the research scholars and young faculty with respect to the peer review process, and also what kind of various citation metrics which is acting as a impact of their research productivity kind of thing. So I'll just share my presentation. At the end, probably you can have a that is we will have a question answer session. I'll just try share. Could you able to see my
Yes,
presentation?
perfectly.
Okay, thank you. Yeah, very good afternoon, one and all, my dear scholars, faculty, and library professionals, and also the top management of Chitkara University. And my sincere thanks to Professor Sushil for connecting me with this program once again. Today I'm going to touch upon some of my experience with respect to scholarly communication, this and the impact of research. I'm Jay Kumar, as you know. This is my email address, library@iitr.ac.in. The participants can connect with me anytime for any of their queries. Probably according to my understanding, whatever I know, I'll share at any time. In this particular slide, the building what you are seeing is the IIT Roorkee's iconic main building, Thompson building. I think very happy to share that Professor Sushil Kumar was our alumni. He's from this great institute. So I request you all to visit our campus once the situation improves, becomes normal, right? With this, I'll just start my session. Here, especially when I just want to just share my points with the scholars, this information literacy is a keyword which has been designed more than 10-15 years back. Then it is very important for both the research scholars and also the library professionals. Because as you know, knowing more about information, knowing more about the resources and knowing more about how efficiently it can be searched and used for your own research purpose. As you know, it is common to all disciplines. It is common to all learning environment. It's all levels of education needs information literacy. And this competency, the word called information literacy competency, is highly important to students and scholars. Of course, they will become our faculty in future. Keep up with it. This means they are supposed to keep up with new developments and new resources specific to their domain, so our subject area, and working knowledge of specialized software which is required for their research purpose, right? With this, in this particular area, there was a guidelines that is information literacy competency standards devised by Association of College and Research Libraries, which is a unit of a division of ALA. It has got a 5 standards. It is a competency standards which is required for the research scholars. Some of the, will be, these points will be relevant to our information professional also, those who are acting in between, that is bringing the scholar and the sources as close as possible. These all 5, if you find time, you just have a look at it. Actually, the same 5 standards, competency standards, has different versions, like later stage. It has been designed for the higher education. Then there was a standards for science and technology, and later part, and it has been adopted by UNESCO, and they call it as a media and computer information literacy kind of thing. So if you look at this point, the scholar, research scholar, is supposed to determine the nature and extent of information needed before starting his research work or something. It should be very clear about what kind of information he need. And also, he should know how to acquire that needed information effectively and efficiently. That's more important. That means he should know the resources and how effectively it can be searched and then collected for his own purpose. And apart from that, as the previous discussion was very important to that, and he also should know how to evaluate the procured information and its sources. And as a result, decide to whether to modify the initial query or seek. It is with respect to information databases kind of thing. And very important thing which you have just discussed, this ethical point of view and economic implications, legal and social issues surrounding the use of information, which is very important to understand in the beginning of your research career, so that it will be very useful for you always. Okay. And also, as understand that information literacy is an ongoing process and an important component of lifelong learning. Need to keep current regarding new developments in their respective. These are the 5 competency standards which is required to be adhered to by our scholars and information seekers, right? And today, which is some few areas which will be of relevant to the research scholars and the young faculty, like scholarly communication process. What is that? And also, to know little about, you all will be familiar with the faculty with respect to peer review process for the kind of information on the new for research scholars. I'll just share a few points on that. The peer review process is considered as a lifeline for quality. Okay, if particular journal is been considered of high ranked or with IF rank or whatever it is, that means the peer review process, what they are doing is perfect and they are meeting the high standard. That's what it shows. And also, we also should be very familiar with domain specific databases. As you all know, we have got a lot of open access databases and say Google Scholar and many other resources are there. But still, when you undertake a research, I think we should consult domain specific databases, which are both, some of them are very few are free and most of them are subscription based. And during your career, you also should learn to manage, use any one of the bibliographic management software like Mendeley, EndNote, Web or Zotero, something like that. So that it will be useful for you to maintain the references during your research career. And while writing paper and writing your thesis, this will be very helpful to you. So that there's a concept called cite when you write. While writing the paper, you can call any reference and you can create the bibliography by click of a button. So it's better you start using any one of the bibliographic management software from the beginning. It will be of immense help to you. And researcher and author identifiers like ORCID, which is a unique ID, or Scopus ID or Scholar ID followed by Web of Science, has to be understood. And every researcher should create one ID, ORCID ID, which will be unique to you, so that it will be easier for you to bring all the like papers together at one place. And it will remove the name ambiguity while searching or looking at your profile in future. Right? These are the few areas I think you should spend time, and then create your ORCID ID and mention this ID whenever you write a paper to the publisher, so that they will connect your profile with that. It's very, very important. And when you, and also I also request you to mention the affiliation, that is your institute, very uniformly and correctly in each and every one of your paper, so that it will be mapped to your organization once they take the detail about what kind of research output up your came out of Sitkara University. It will be nice. So you should just use the author of that is affiliation uniformly. And as you know, last discussion was involving a lot of copyright and permission and fair use. It's you are responsible for that. You should understand very clearly what can be done, what can should not be done, kind of thing. Always, as you know, you have to follow a thing, strict rule called share with care. Before sharing anything, you just doubly ensure that you are not violating any of the guidelines, right? And research and publication ethics awareness, I think as professor has mentioned, you can consult and take guidance from your supervisor, or COPE is a website which gives all the guidelines to you. And here, not only publication, in research, especially in medical research or biotechnology research and also medical research, there are various research ethics is there. How to use experimental specimens, kind of thing. Many things are there. So you have to be very thorough with those ethical points and then follow adherently, meticulously. And as it is very important to use any one of the similarity checking software or like Urkund or Turnitin for your own purpose. As during the discussion, we all should differentiate. These softwares will be useful to identify the similarity only. It is not defined what kind of plagiarism percentage is that. For example, I will tell you, at some certain situation, a 50% of similarity may not be considered as a plagiarism at all. At the same time, it's another case if 5% of similarity may be considered as a plagiarism, because where is the concept has been taken out. That concept, the main concept or model, if you are just taking it from others, that is be treated as this. So these two are entirely different. And this percentage, because what my experience is, supervisor is the right person to decide whether it's a plagiarism is involved or not. Okay. And where it has been dealt. So this software will give you guidelines where the similar portion is appearing around the world. And also limitation is there, because Urkund will just search its own database, whereas Turnitin will have little expanded database of even journal articles, complete journal article into its own database. And also even papers, those who are in print also in under preparation also there, that may consider sometimes. And there's another product from Turnitin called, there's another product which takes care of the that is those who are under process also will be checked. And as you know, OAI, Open Access Initiative, the CC, Creative Commons, which Professor Sushil was mentioning in the previous this one, I will touch a little on this. Okay. So today's discussion, I will just, there are some responses when it comes to research scholars, faculty and others. Being a library professional, we have to play an important role. You have to bring our scholars or faculty as close as possible to the resources which we are there, it will be useful for them. You have to become a reference, you have to provide reference and research support service. You should give a helping hand. You should hold their hand when you walk along, okay? So that they will may feel comfortable. They should feel that is, they should just look at you. Oh, there is one person to understand my requirement and share his knowledge, or give at least a direction how to go about it, right? And every professional can try to become subject librarians of their own interest, because their own basic degree, masters, whatever it is, they should become master of that particular subject to know more about the resources in that subject, and they should know how he can transfer the knowledge to the scholars. So, and as I told you, we should give at point of some point of time, we should extend personalized support, which gives them more confidence to our scholars. And by this way, you are empowering the researchers. And as you know, it should be part of our academic and research journey. Once you are serving your organization, you are part of their learning, academic learning and research activity. And also you'll be very much required by the top management to give them some ideas on some data, some count as and when required, right? So you should also play an important role as a important information provider to a top level management as and when required from the right source. And as you know, library as a hub for teaching, learning and research work. So in this task, being a librarian information professional, you should put yourself fully involved and enjoy your profession. Enjoy serving others. And also it will also give you a satisfaction, right? Then today's discussion, I'll touch upon a little on peer review process and citation metrics, then open access initiative, little history about that. And there are some author guidelines permitted by publishers to what extent you can share your resource, that is published paper, whether as a preprint or post-print, that is accepted version kind of thing. And there are some guidelines known as, this has been denoted by Romeo colors, which I'll touch upon. And Juliet is the guidelines, which gives clear guidelines with respect to the funder's requirement. Okay. And some of the screenshot, I'll show some of the platforms, which will give you some little idea about that, right? And when it comes to peer review process, as I told you, it is a backbone of quality, right? If some quality journals are there, or in particular domain, you can name few, that means if it is very good, means they are following a very stringent peer review process. And another important thing is the peer review process is not the process to discourage or reject your paper. This process is to improve the quality, okay, and ensure it has been provided on the platform. In this one, there are four contributors are there. One being author, what they feel is they want to have their work quickly and fairly assessed. The assessment has to be done as quickly as possible, and it should be done fairly. That is important. And as a reviewers, as a present, my faculty will become a reviewer soon. Okay, the young faculty will become a reviewer once they become a master in that particular area. What they do, they really support their peers, that is the research scholars in the research community, by evaluating their work and helping to make it better. This is important. Their ideas, they will try to, they are supposed to point out how it can be improved further, right? And comes editorial board members. Their task is to oversee a fair peer review process so that they can maintain the quality for and also provide the the body of knowledge in the particular domain, whether it's a physics or mathematics or biosciences, and helps to improve their peers' work. Okay. And readers as such, as the end user, they should be assured that published articles have been assessed by subject experts for its quality. Okay. This peer review process is a backbone of quality assurance of your own scientific communication or scholarly communication, it's known as, right? In this peer review, there are two methods. You all will be familiar. One is single blind, another one is double blind. In single blind, reviewers will know who is the author is, okay? Whereas author will not know who is the reviewer are. And whereas in double blind, there are both the parties will not know each other, because to avoid some kind of biases. But some of the studies shows the success rate in the single blind review method of some journals are little higher when compared to double blind review. The reason may be because since the reviewers will be knowing about the author and their affiliation, it will allow them to probe little further about the reviewer, that is author's strength, they can also guide them further to improve that this one, right? There are two methods. One is single blind and another one is double blind, which all will be familiar with this, right? Then I'm just moving to, once you publish your quality paper, which undertake the highly, that is with the good peer review method, definitely it will be referred by others, right? This image really just show the relationship between your papers and also its references and how it has been interlinked. If you just see these blocks at the top and bottom, there are a set of articles written in 2002 and 2003. Each and every paper will be referring some related paper which has published earlier as a references or bibliography, which we used to do in our paper or thesis, right? This will be dating back. Once you connect all this one, the index, if you create, that index is called citation index. The index created by using the cited references is known as citation references, right? That pulling up related papers. There one person, he is a professor, Eugene Garfield. He is considered to be father of citation index. He is instrumental in bringing this particular concept into a practice, right? When he was doing some project in mid 50s and 60s in a medical library indexing catalog, something ignited him. The references given at the bottom, whether it can serve some purpose, whether it has got some relevancy. Then he has undertaken pilot project of National Institute of Health during 1962, and he has developed a literature on genetics. At that time, he just included the references also. And with that outcome was 1963, the Science Citation Index, otherwise affectionately called SCI, has appeared. Over the period, it was appearing in the form of print, then CD, then floppy disk based and CD format, everything. Now it is available as a web of science. Now it's known as like. And when you find time, just click on this homepage of Professor Eugene Garfield. He's a wonderful information scientist. He shares his invention still it holds good. That is still, even though there is a lot of discussion on citation and other things, there are debates and discussion, but still this citation will count all the time for some more, even another century or so, with a lot of derivatives. Okay. He has passed at the age of 91. And please find time to have a look at that obituary, which has appeared in The Scientist and in our frontline by Professor Balram, our ex-director of IISc Bangalore. Right. And he's the person, Eugene Garfield, was instrumental in publishing the journal, the multidisciplinary journal called Life Sciences. It's The Scientist during those days. And also there's an important, I think my senior colleagues will accept, there's another important product called Current Contents. This has appeared during 80s, 90s, 70s kind of thing. It is very important document for the research scholars. What this Current Contents provides during those days, print era, that is the content pages of forthcoming journals will be appearing in this particular compendium. It's a handheld palm size printout, print book. Once you open, the content pages of all the nearly 100 or 120 journals will be reprinted there. And important thing is, at the end of that one, it will have a keywords and referring to the particular journal page, or the author's complete postal address. As Professor Lakotia was mentioning, earlier days, those 30, 30, 40 years back, so everyone used to write a reprint request. Once their paper is published, publisher used to provide a 25 to 50 copies of reprint of the particular article along with the page number, volume number, everything to the particular author. So author will be the happiest person to share those reprints in print form in a wonderful cover with the colorful stamp, because those days, you know, our senior professor used to enjoy collecting those colorful stamps which we receive from overseas, right? This journal was the foundation for that Current Contents, right? Now everything is available on web. And why this citation is very important. Okay. Citation, as I told you, it has been considered as one of the quality measure. Still, I'm telling you, it is considered as one of the quality measure for with respect to find out the article quality, time cited over the period kind of time. And in the later stage, another professor has mentioned, devised a Hutch index, which I'll touch upon in the next slide, which will be of use to my both information professional and also the research scholars to understand much better. And you all will be familiar, journal impact factor has been devised using the impact citations over the period of 2 years, past 2 years, right? Here comes Hutch Index. It is named after, it has been devised or recommended by Professor E. Hertz, Professor of Physics of University of California, San Diego. He just proposes the index as a simplest defined as the number of papers with citation number higher or equal to Hutch, same number, as a useful index to characterize the scientific output of a researcher. He has published in 2005, which is available on, I think, archive. And also it has been appeared as a paper in PNAS, Proceedings of Royal Academic, okay, Royal Society of Academy. And you can click the link, you will get the paper. And how this Hutch index can be calculated in simple way. You just take one particular author and collect the time cited of each and every one of his paper and just sort it according to the highly cited author. In the right side, you could see one table where the left side column gives highly cited order, right side it is time cited. If you rank those papers from highly cited to next, something like that, the highly cited rank 1 cites 20 times, rank 2 cites 19 times. At one point of time, this highly cited order and the time cited will meet at one point. This point, this number is known as Hutch index. For example, in this particular table, 10 of his paper has been cited at least. You have to underline the word at least. Okay. At least 10 times. Hope it's, I'm right. Once the 11th cited order reaches the time cited 11, his Hutch index will increase to Hutch. So in this way, the quality and consistency of quantity and quality can be measured by simple number by known as Hutch index. Okay. The same thing if you plot a curve in this left side graph you are seeing, you know, in the x axis, if you just mention the rank number, highly cited order, 1, 2, 3, something like that. In y axis, if you just put a number of time cited, so usually the first rank will be a higher number, then it goes that at one point of time, the recent papers will meet only zero. So it will make a curve. At that point of time, if you cut at 45 degree, it will meet at one point. This point is known as Hutch. That is Hutch number of his papers has been cited Hutch times. I think you hope you understand this. This will be very useful for little clarity for the young researchers so that the same can be applied with respect to organization as a whole or the journal as a whole in place of journal impact factor or something. For example, if you take some organization, if you just take the data for last 5 years, you can just find out the Hutch index of those organizations for the last 5 years. And if you compare similar organization, that means, for example, if my organization's impact factor is 84, means 84 of my organization article has been cited 84 times or 174 times, something like that. Okay. This Hutch index is a simplest way, but this has to be used very carefully. You can compare the Hutch index with a similar kind of domain and also professors with similar years of experience, because definitely senior professors will have Hutch index value will be more, right? Hope I'm little clear on this. And where the citation and the indexes, those kind of has been considered. As you know, as I mentioned, citation that counts for awards and honors and fellowships and awarding projects and assignment and positions. And of course, for institutional rankings like NIRF, National Institute Ranking Framework, Times Higher Education, Education Network Framework, QS World University Ranking, FT Ranking for Management Studies, everywhere. Then important one component has been considered as the quantity and quality of the papers, which plays an important role. So again, I mentioned you this impact. This is citation count. Those things can be considered as one of the measure only, because the citation of engineering fraternity can be different way. The number of patents filed, number of project executed, number of installation, what they have done, something like that. There are many metrics, but still, this citation has been considered as one of the measure, right? And you all will be familiar, journal impact factor, which is takes a 2 years average of, that is citation received during third year for the last 2 years paper average, that it's known as JCR, that is journal impact factor, which has been published by JCR Journal Citation Report. Now, it was earlier with Thomson ISI, now it is with Clarivate Analytics. And then there are few counterparts to this particular JIS journal impact factor. There's a Scopus has come out with a site score. Instead of 2 years average, they consider the 3 year average. Okay. The citation received during fourth year for the papers of last 3 years is considered as a site score, right? And there are these two, journal impact factor and also the site score is not differentiating the subject to what extent, because we cannot compare the citation index of one journal in, say, physics with mathematics or with biosciences. The range will be different. For that, there are two alternative metrics has come, SJR, SciMago, and also SNIP. When you find time, look at this one. I think Scopus always provided openly with all these three metrics for any given journal, right? And as you all know, there are few citation cum bibliographic database, multidisciplinary, Web of Science and Scopus. These two are subscription-based. Scopus by Elsevier, Web of Science by Thomson Reuters. Now it is with Clarivate. And wonderfully, Google Scholar is a free platform. But only thing is, Web of Science and Scopus, they follow different journal inclusion policy. Whereas Google Scholar is your responsibility to create your own profile using your own Gmail account once. And by default, at the first time, it will bring out the existing literature from its own database and list out to you. You have to validate whether it belongs to you or somebody else. You have to just filter that one and update as and when you publish new things. It has got free hand to you. You can include anything, whatever you publish, into Google Scholar. And Web of Science and Scopus, they follow different criteria to include the journal. So you will come across many discussion why the number is different from Web of Science, Scopus, Google Scholar is different. For example, Web of Science shows 100 is my time cited. Scopus shows 125, whereas Google Scholar shows 150. Because the journal, what they index matters. Okay. It differs from these two databases. So they follow a stringent journal inclusion policy. That only depends. And also they have to wait for the journal to stabilize. Okay, so Google Scholar gives you freedom for you to add any of your publication, whether it has been indexed by others or else other your own also. There's another platform called Sitesier. Also, it's limited to computer and information science. There are two byproducts out of Web of Science and Scopus, which is known as Insights and SciVal. These two, Insights takes base data from Web of Science. SciVal takes base data from Scopus. This is also a subscription-based product, which your organization has to subscribe. It is this product will be useful for the top level management or the project groups to understand how them to evaluate among the organization, what are the future trends kind of thing. These are the highly priced subscription-based analytics tools by Reuters and Elsevier. And here I would like to spend little time for the benefit of my faculty and also scholars. Once you were done with publishing your paper in quality journal with some good, that is impact factor, right? But there are some discussion. There are, that is a measurement within that particular set of journal in particular subject area. It is called quartile based Q1, Q2, Q3, Q4, like that, right? Only up to Q4 it is there. How it has been done? Web of Science, for example, also Scopus, they follow different subject schema. It is called subject schema. Here, Web of Science subject, the schema, they follow 36 subject categories earlier. Now it has been increased to 255. Each and every journal indexed by Web of Science as considered for journal impact factor will be classified under one or more subject categories. I am once again tell you, each and every journal may find a place in one or more subject category, right? Once it's been done among 255 subject category, that total number will differ. For example, this particular journal by name IEEE Internet of Things journal, is having impact factor of 7.596. Usually impact factor will have 3 decimal accuracy. And also it shows, this is a very old data, but now presently you will see 2019 this one. And if the same journal has been considered under 3 different subject categories, computer science, information system, engineering, electrical engineer, electronic, and also under telecommunication. If you see the second, that is column there, it shows 3 of 146, 10 of 262, 5 of 89. What does it mean? For example, if you take last telecommunication, this particular journal, IEEE Internet of Things, is ranked 5 among 89 other titles, which has been under considered in the telecommunication subject area. Okay. This particular total number, whether it's 146, 262 or 89 or like that, I just take an example of 100. For example, some title has got a listing of 100, which has been indexed, which has got a JF, journal impact factor. Once I sort according to the highly cited order, the first 25, 1 to 25 will fall under Q1, 26 to 50 will fall under Q2, 51 to 75 will fall under Q3, that 76 to 100 will fall under Q4. This is how this Q1, Q2, Q3, Q4 being followed. For example, the same, instead of 100, if it is 103 titles are there in particular subject, the remaining 3 will be distributed among the Q1, Q2, Q3, right? So Q1, Q2, Q3 will have 26 titles of that same order, and Q4 will have 25. This is how this Q1, Q2, Q3 has been followed, a Q4 has been observed by both Web of Science and also Scopus, right? My best advice is, my dear scholars and faculty, you try to publish your paper initially, whichever they accept. Over the period, once you become master, then look for improving from Q4 to Q2, Q4 to Q3, then Q3 to Q2, Q3 to Q1. Definitely, by this is the, as I mentioned, this citation, it will attract more. I'm not very, we cannot guarantee, but it shows that a highly quality paper, journals by the peers. Hope you, I could make you understand little about Q1, Q2. I'll just proceed next to that. Right. And my next topic on discussion is, as the previous discussion also was there, why we should pay for our own paper to access again. We are writing paper, we are just submitting, why we have to pay, or my organization has to subscribe to access the same. For this, I think 20 years back, there was a brainstorming session among physicists and many other discipline, and they have just come out. There are a lot of discussion has happened in the 2001, 2003 and 2003 October. It's called 3 different places, Budapest, Bethesda and Berlin. This is little history about Open Access Initiative, which was instrumental in making the publisher understand the importance of the research, that is funded research project, information has to be available to each and everyone. It's called Open Access Policy. Out of this only, because over the period, this Open Access Policy has evolved, and Open Access Journal has come, everything. The problem is, once this has improved, the quality was in questions. By with the name of Open Access, the quality is not being maintained by many predatory and other journal. It has brought wrong outlook to this concept, right? This is the history about that. And you all know, publisher has come out with alternate policy. As you know, this peer review process is very important. It's a lifeline. For that, the every publisher, commercial or society or whatever it is, they require a premium. That premium has been charged in the form of subscription, or now they have come out with alternative called in hybrid journal. They charge APC, article processing charge. For example, if you are want to make your article free to everyone, so you have to pay $3,000, approximately, I'm telling, or your funding agency should pay to that one. Once you do that, that particular paper published in a highly ranked journal will be available to the entire world to access that particular article alone. Okay, whatever you have been paid, what has been paid to that, right? That may increase impact, or number of citations may increase. Many things are there. Because of this open access discussion and everything, there are very many improvement has come. Publisher has come out with open access alternative with payment, or some of the journals are completely open access kind of thing. Whenever you just see, nothing can be made free. If some thing is acting as a open access journal, is they are making free, they have to invest some money somewhere to provide the journal to you or in more sustained way, right? So when it comes to peer review process, these journals, you know, they just charge subscription fee. But problem is, this most of the commercial publisher, they charge exorbitant fee because they put a high rate of profit and other things. Whereas society comparatively, you know, they also just take subscription, but it's comparatively little reasonable. Okay, these are the few different model, and also this open access repositories was in existence for many years, like X-Archive or Bio-Archive and many other things. And publishers has come out with a hybrid access, open access model in order to support the open access guidelines or mandate of the funding agency, right? Yeah. As professor was mentioning about CC, that's Creative Commons and other thing. This, I think, this is the C denotes copyright. The CC denotes the product is for what is following Creative Commons license. That means the CC, whenever you publish your product for the first time, freely available, you can make it as a CC, means others can use it judiciously, just having attribution, that is acknowledging you. And you can also give any one of the symbol, a combination of this with all this meaning, no derivative works, share alike, or non-commercial. Whenever this product with CC has been reproduced, it has to just adhere to the whatever licenses it has been originally published. Okay. Whereas once it comes to C, that is copyright, as the previous discussion also, many things were there. As and when we publish any paper in commercial or society, any journal, by default, we give a transfer the copyright to the publisher. That's it, right? With that, if you want to reuse anything, you need to get permission from them. Okay. And as I just mentioned, because of this OAI, lot of discussion, deliberation, now publishers have come out with a lot of guidelines for the authors to share their different versions and different ways. What are the publishers' open access policy? Now, as I told you, because of the great effort of the subject specialist, especially in the area of physics, and this open access has reached this stage, and this majority of publishers now allow archiving of journal articles subject to condition. I'm just underlining the word subject to conditions. In most cases, they allow archiving of the author's final version in their personal websites, institutional repositories, or subject repositories, but not the PDF file of the published version or any other research gate or something that is not allowed, right? Whereas many publishers, they allow you to publish your own submitted version, or some of the publishers will also allow the final accepted version after peer review process. That is called, here it comes. Okay. Okay, here, yeah. It's called preprint, postprint, and reprint. Okay, preprint is the version which you submit in Word format or LaTeX format, whatever it is. Postprint is the final accepted version. Reprint is the version with volume number, page number, everything in a final PDF form, right? Now I just go back to this. There's a project called sherpa.ac.uk. I request the research scholars to just go to this website, try to understand some of the services provided there by them. As I discussing earlier, no, this Romeo, Colors, Juliet, Funders Research. In this left side, if you see Sherpa services, the first one is Romeo. It gives the publishers copyright and archiving policies of each and every publisher. And similarly, Juliet gives the funders mandate. What is the requirement of the funders? Especially in Juliet, I think presently our DST and DBT, Department of Biotechnology, Department of Science and Technology guidelines are there. I think in India is yet to get mandated by other funding agencies. Whereas international level, all the things are there. And please find time to look at this University of Nottingham project website, sherpa.ac.uk, right? And once you go to Romeo Click, it will just give a list of publishers who support green color or blue or yellow or white. The right side is the archiving policy of authors. To what extent the publisher allows you to share your preprint or postprint or whatever it is. Even some publisher, he will allow you to provide the final PDF version of your own paper in your own website, especially IEEE. But only thing is, you should take their permission once, right? Please spend little time, try to understand this one accordingly. Happily, you can share your thing. You are in different format and different platform without violating the copyright. And another thing which I would like to share is the permissions. For example, if I return a paper and submit it to a journal, if I want to reuse your image which I submitted to that particular journal article, there is always channel available. You can write to the publisher and mention this particular portion of the image of my own paper. I want to use it in another publication. What is expected from you by all the publisher is they want to know which portion you want to reproduce and where you want to reproduce, kind of thing. They will go through quickly. They will give you email by permission. That means then after taking that permission, you can very well happy to do that. But still, once you reproduce that particular image in your own monograph or books in future, you have to mention a credit. That is source, that is copyright permission from Wiley, permission from something like that. Okay. So this copyright and permission is a very important thing. You should just understand and follow meticulously. It will be very useful for you. Right. Then once you just look at the statistics of this Romeo, that is open access policy supported with some conditions by publishers. If you see, there are more than 1,000 publishers, around 40%, they supports green open access, and 33% blue, and white means they will not support anything. Especially American Chemical Society is the one which will not allow you to share any of your preprint, postprint or something. Still some publishers are there, but it is on the rise. They also trying to come out with different models, payment models, right? Please find time to look at, try to understand these Romeo colors and its meaning when you do your research. And as I told you, there's a Sherpa, there's another website which gives the funders guideline to what extent what funders are expecting from you once you take any funding from them. So because many funders will insist on you to publish your own research work on a publicly or open access mode as a condition. At this stage of point of time, as you know, many other publisher has come out with the APC model by payment, because individual faculty or scholars cannot spend $3,000, which is equal to 600 fellowship for my research scholars, or some other I can get equipment for that money. It's very difficult. So what I'm requesting is, if you are really identify, or if it has been accepted in high quality journal like Q1 or Q2, if it is having open access by OAPC method, it's better to get the funding from the funders already. And whenever you write in hereafter, when you write a proposal for research funding, you just include a separate component for APC charges. Okay. For example, if I just think that I may bring out five research papers out of this particular project over the period of next 3 years, it's better to include $15,000. Okay. 5 × $3,000 as a component, this one as a part of your research project, so that you will not find by that way you can just satisfy the funders, and also by that way you can make your paper visible to the entire world, which will definitely increase the impact and also, right? Please spend some time. And now I just show quickly on few search platform which are all domain specific. As I told you, even though many, many open access resources are available, are subscribed resources, I just request the research scholars, whichever database your organization is subscribing already, please try to spend little time to understand in depth, little, just 5 minutes or 10 minutes of each and every product, to what extent it can be, it will be useful to you, and what extent it can be searched more efficiently, kind of thing. Here I'm just sharing, it's IEEE Explore. This is a platform which gives the journals published by IEEE, not only that, conference proceedings and standards, everything. And most of the platforms or subscribed resources will be IP based. You will be allowed to access seamlessly once you connect from your institutional network, and you can download or do whatever you want from that subscribed content. But each and every platform has got a personalized ID creation facility. What it does for you? If you identify five product platform, this particular thing is the Elsevier's Science Direct platform, which gives is a search and retrieval method for journals, books, everything. Every platform provides a facility for you to create an ID and password. If you identify five platforms which is of relevant to my field, say nanoscience or whatever it is, it's better after understanding what kind of information it's very useful. If it is useful, you create your own ID within that particular platform and make note of the ID and password feature used. It will help you to get personalized alert services to your email ID on a regular basis, which will just save a lot of time for you. They will update you. If you once you create a search criteria with combination of some keywords, some condition, you store it in that particular profile, they will, you can opt for receiving the updates by weekly or monthly. You will get whatever journal has been added to that. You will get the thing. So I request the scholars to identify the right product. And if it is very useful, create your own ID password within that particular platform. That particular platform is accessible to you through your organizational network. That is fine. But if you find that is very useful, you register only once and set your search criteria and store the search alert services and many other things. You please click on the help button and try to get more on this. Here comes the Springer link. Okay. Most of the platform will have a search box at the top and advanced search. Many things are there. But spend 10 minutes to know more about what are the method and which I can search more effectively, whether that particular product is using some classification scheme inbuilt. Not only limited to journals, there are many patent databases are available, and just then standards which are very much relevant to engineering fraternity, engineering scholars, those resources you should explore, right? Here comes APS, American Physical Society, then comes ACS. Every publisher, whether it's a commercial or society, they provide a wonderful, highly intuitive and user-centric search interface. Only thing is, it's up to you to make use of that thing as best. In this aspect, because I request my librarian information professional to go little in-depth and try to help our scholars to understand how effectively this can be searched, so that it will save a lot of their time. This here comes the SciFinder, which is a chemistry bibliographic database of platform. Then comes MathSciNet, mathematics-based product. And ASTM for it's a standards and journals, very important for mechanical engineer and engineers. And ASME, this also with this. Then American set of, I just shown a screens only, just landing page of each and every platform. But whatever resource you have got under your organizational subscription, please spend time and identify the right resource and bookmark or create a separate meaningful folder and store those direct links for your future use, and set your own ID password to get further alert services. This is AIP, American Institute of Physics. And I think I come to an end. Just open for your question and answer. I just stop my share, then I'm available for you. Right? Thank you very much. Yes, Professor. Professor, can you unmute yourself? Please unmute, Professor.
Yeah.
Yes.
Thank you. Actually, great. And I feel that this information is a huge pull, and you had focused on the open access policy that for the print version of the manuscript, whether that is the submitted, reviewed, or then after accepted and then published, all the version of the manuscript you defined according to the Sherpa Romeo. And it is if you allow me, actually, I can demonstrate that thing here.
Please.
Is it visible, sir?
Yes, sir. Yes,
yeah. Please. So yeah. That point basically you had mentioned here, I have put on every journal website. Wonderful. You can see the open access policy, and along with it, the point you actually mentioned, the manuscript policy, open access policy of the publisher, and might be it very few people observe it, the funding, the funders policy. Right. So when it matches with the funders policy, that becomes actually along the planners. That is the different point. But here I want to show in favor of your statement, this SEPA Romeo policy for all the version, that publication information, publisher policy for the published version, accepted version, and submitted version. So
wonderful,
here,
wonderful.
Here we have put all in a CC BY license, and I got very, I'm very excited to know about it, that every researcher basically should know all these things, that what is the impact of the CC BY license and CC BY NC, non-commercial CC BY ND, non-derivative CC BY SA, similar alike. So one researcher basically have to check it and do the work accordingly. So I just come back on my point, sir. This point I had observed, and I want to show it through the
great actually.
Right. So if there is any other question from the audience side, most welcome. Please, it will be great if to take your questions, and if there is. Right. Is there anyone who basically interested to ask the question? Because I'm basically announcing it in advance, but on the 5th April, basically I am just trying to make a more possibility. Actually, sir, as you know, that there is a gap between the library and researchers. In the beginning, you had mentioned this point. Right, indirectly, right. But I know this thing, that there is a gap in India between the regular researchers and the library. Library have large of information that can be shared with the researcher to guide them for the best in any emerging area. You people do the bibliography and scientometric study. You know everything, but the regular researchers, they are not aware about any things. Basically, they are blindly working in a specific area, and you people know that this is the specific keywords, these are the specific journal for your domain. You know this is the emerging area, this keyword is now growing now from since last 10 years or 20 years, you know everything. So for that purpose, actually, we are going to organize one event to fulfill that gap between the researchers and librarian on the 5th, and we will see. But here, my dear friends, the research scholar, faculty, and anyone, if there is any question, it will be great to take care, right? Because the information that you had included was wonderful, because I am a regular researcher, I am not librarian, as you know, but during all these things, publication, I had learned all these things, and now I can understand the importance of that.
Professor, small request to you is,
yes,
if some of the participants are interested in my presentation, please feel free to share the PDF version of mine to them.
Okay.
If they feel it is useful.
So thank you, sir. Thank you so much for your time and providing all this information. And today might be young researcher, and those who are early in research, they cannot understand immediately all the point. But one day they will realize, because you define very clearly Q1, Q2, Q3, Q4, and all the institution ranking basically depends on. People basically follow the multidisciplinary research and publish the article in multidisciplinary research journal. But when the people NIRF and other start their ranking, they find those Q1, Q2, Q3, Q4. And the journal in a specific domain. So I personally feel that we have to convey this kind of information to every researcher, so they basically decide their strategy for the upcoming research. So my efforts are towards that side, and now thankful to you, sir.
I agree with you, Professor. At the same time, what I request is library professionals should become masters and should give a helping hand, as you are just bring the gap between the sources and their requirement kind of thing. And research scholars also, once they know some good technique in particular database or something, they should just percolate their knowledge to their juniors. Yes. So that they will save a lot of time in their research career, right?
Yes.
With this few words, I think I thank Professor Sushil for the wonderful opportunity, to Chitkara University management, and also the participant for the wonderful opportunity for me to share my thoughts. Wish you all very best for your wonderful academic and research career and research journey. Thank you very much.
Thank
I take leave. Sir. Thank you. Bye.
Thank you. And now we are moving towards the Manoj Kumar, sir. He is from the InfliptNet and basically taking care. And you people, some of you may be aware about him. To know his course about to the plagiarism and all these things, and he is basically taking care of all the thing in India, not only through the courses, but he is very what I should say about to him, that let's move toward the Dr. Manoj sir. Are you available here? Please unmute your mic and video, and over to you, sir. Manoj sir. And it will be great that if social media influencer, right, and say a number of the things on social media for the culture, for the education, and there are so many things that they have to share with you all. So, my dear friends, just welcome to the Manoj sir. Manoj sir, please, over to you.